See so many people back after the break. That's great news. So we're going to continue with our program. Our next speaker is Ankit Patel from Rice and Baylor College of Medicine. He graduated with PhD from Harvard about 8 years ago, and then went off chasing missiles at Lincoln Lab, and had for a while title of the fastest man in the world, working on super fast trading systems for the financial industry. Since coming back to academics, he has been working in this very interesting area, the interplay between machine learning and brain science. And he's here today to talk about his work on deep rendering model, which was inspired, and deep convolutional nets, that is inspired by this work in neuroscience. So take it away, Ankit.
Thank you.
Oh, we clap, right?
No. Thank you, Rich. So I'm gonna talk to you guys a little bit today about the work we do in my lab here. Been just started a year ago after being a postdoc in Rich Baranek's lab, so. A lot of exciting and interesting stuff at the intersection of machine learning and neuroscience. So you guys have probably heard a lot of these deep learning words thrown around as we've kind of seen in the media, and it's a very exciting time for deep learning and AI in general. But I want to take a few minutes to kind of formalize what deep learning is and what it's good for, and focus on what it's really failing at right now and where the limitations are, and how we can improve them. So why do we need deep learning to start with? So if you guys look at some of these images here, you can easily tell that these are airplanes, bicycles, birds, and cars. However, to a computer, the images that hit the computer's retina are very, very different. And so the sheer amount of variation within each of these categories, so-called nuisance variation, is the real reason why a lot of these perceptual tasks are so difficult. And this applies outside of just vision. You can think of speech recognition, recognizing phonemes. There's a lot of nuisances in the world, and our brains have learned to disentangle them, but we have spent almost half a century trying to do this with computers. So the trouble with nuisances is that they're extremely high dimensional, right? There are a lot of them in the scene before you, and they drastically affect the way that the image looks to your retina, to your eyes. And so in order to solve this problem, how do we deal with this nuisance variation? We need some way of extracting the targets that we care about in the world, right? If we care about classification, we want to tell the difference between cars and planes. We need a way to distinguish between those two categories while also being invariant to all those other nuisance variables, such as change in lighting, changes in pose, changes in style, and so on and so forth. And so it's this dance, the interplay between trying to get the target right while also being invariant to all of these other nuisance features that makes perceptual tasks very difficult. So we'd love to do some sort of processing or invent some sort of algorithm that is selective to the features we care about and invariant to the features we don't. Of course, this is the holy grail of all of machine learning. If you could do this in a general way, learn disentangled representations, as they're called, you as one of the earlier speakers said, you should probably leave the room, file a patent, and then come back in a few years. So in general, we shouldn't expect this problem to be easy to solve. However, there are some potential solutions. And one sort of solution that already exists out in the world is our brains. None of you really realized how hard perception was, right? You just, as a young child, you perceived the world and categorized objects and heard sounds, and you didn't really consciously think about it. But the brain does these computations, and the architectures by which it actually does these computations were just being discovered in the early 60s, and some of them served as inspiration for the modern-day deep learning architectures, such as convolutional nets. So there's a pattern in the brain of this alternation between building selectivity, illustrated here by a bunch of ands, and building tolerance, illustrated here by a bunch of ors. And the intuition is that you want to be selective to the features that help discriminate for whatever target task you care about, while building tolerance to those nuisances that I mentioned earlier. So enter neural networks. So neural networks, which have had many sort of births and deaths over the years, neural networks are a general sort of architecture for taking in inputs, doing layers and layers of processing, and spitting out some sort of task-dependent output. You can think of your brain as a much, much fancier neural network than the ones we'll talk about in the talk today. But the key is that the layers of processing have both linear and nonlinear elements. And the nonlinear processing is absolutely critical to achieving any kind of success on these high nuisance tasks. Now, neural networks had always had a ton of, so much hype around them. And you know, the hype has been shot up and down many times over the years. I think the recent hype is a little bit different in that I think it's not going to suddenly drop anytime soon. And I'll describe a little bit about why. So even if it is overhyped, I don't know that it's overhyped the way that the past neural network failures were overhyped. Okay, so some current successes and failures in deep learning. So one of the great successes has been object recognition. So this is the task of, given an input image, telling you know, which class or categories of objects are in the image. So recognizing this is a leopard, recognizing that this is apparently a Madagascar cat. So you know, these kinds of tasks have, in the past 5 years, have seen enormous amounts of success. And this has been kind of the spark for this recent sort of rebirth of deep learning methods. And you can notice here that you can classify all these different pumpkins despite the variation in their appearance. Some other great successes to show you kind of the depth of what is learned by these neural networks is the ability to transfer the style from one, say, work of art to another image. So here on the upper left, we have a content image. This is the University of Tübingen. And this is a river near the university. And here are three pieces of art. This is Van Gogh's Starry Night. And with some of the techniques that people have developed using convolutional net, you can take the style of Van Gogh's Starry Night and impose it on the content of this picture of Tübingen. And so you see here, it looks as if Van Gogh painted a picture of this. So you can see that the importance of this is that these deep neural network architectures are learning something fundamental that helps one distinguish between the content and the style of the image. And as we'll see, these multi-scale representations are really absolutely critical to solving all kinds of perceptual tasks. Of course, you can have some fun and try this on Lovett Hall and then see what happens. And if you guys want, you can go online and kind of try this out on your own personal images. It's fun to do with family members and friends' images, especially. Another application of deep learning is building generative models for natural images. So you have, for example, here you have, you know, these might look, at first at glance, if you look at it very quickly, it looks like dogs, but you look a little bit closer and you realize that they're highly deformed, very unnatural looking dogs. But they still have this essence of dogness to them. And so this is the kind of things that you can expect coming out of a neural network that's learned something about dogs, but clearly hasn't learned everything about dogs. Taking this to sort of more serious applications, you can take convolutional neural networks, which are very good image processing engines, and use them for all kinds of medical applications, any kind of medical vision type task. And I'll point you to one of my colleagues' talks later on, Craig Russin. He's a professor at Baylor and Rice and also co-founder of a startup called Medical Informatics, which has a very, very interesting business plan. They've built a unified data platform for all data inside of a hospital. So this is the kind of thing where, you know, deep learning and machine learning can kind of seep into medicine, which has historically had lots of data, but maybe fragmented and less accessible to the public. And so now that this company has this kind of data, hopefully we can use machine learning to do better. So that's one of the collaborations we're excited about. Outside of vision, you can do a lot of interesting things with deep learning in other domains, such as text. So, for example, if you train deep neural networks to try and learn how to predict characters in a Linux source code, for example, it can generate code for you. So this code was not written by a human. This code was written by a neural network that got to train on the entire Linux code base, so millions and millions of lines of code. And for the uninitiated, this looks realistic, right? Even for the initiated, it looks realistic. You have to look really closely and start to realize that this is complete nonsense. And it's amazing, though, to see what just a neural network trained just to predict the next character, what it learns just by trying to predict the next character. So, you know, things that, you know, there are patterns in this kind of, and I've spent a lot of time reading through this data. The kinds of patterns it learns, I would have attributed to a much more intelligent task than just predicting the next character. And so this is one of the sort of surprises in deep neural networks, is that they seem unreasonably effective. For very simple tasks, they seem to give you much more than you put in. Okay, so just to show you, you can generate algebraic topology textbooks. Okay, so not that any of you are interested in algebraic topology, but look at all this math, and it can generate this without even having to know any math. So it's really, really exciting. But, you know, this begs a question, which is, you know, if these things can learn such incredible patterns and associations in the data, you know, how are they doing this? Like, what are they actually doing? And if we don't fully understand how they're learning what they learn, how they're encoding their knowledge, is that going to cause us trouble? And the answer is that it can cause us trouble, right? How do you trust a black box? Well, you know, unfortunately, one of the users of the Tesla autopilot, who was really excited about it, unfortunately died in a car accident. And you know, the whole problem was that his autopilot, which had a deep neural network based vision system in it, misclassified this truck as a billboard. And because it thought it was a billboard, and because the ambiguity and distance in a billboard, it ignored it. And he was sleeping at the wheel because he really trusted the autopilot, and it hit and this is the result. So, you know, no matter how much you train a neural network, if you don't really understand what's going on inside the black box, it could have fatal consequences. And of course, not just in self-driving, but especially in medical image analysis, and you know, all kinds of other dangerous applications. So it's very important, and this is one of the motivating reasons for having a theory of deep learning, right? So it's not enough just to have performance on benchmarks and things like that, which is a good thing in machine learning, but when we get out into the real world, how can we really trust those black boxes? So several motivating reasons aside from that is also we need to improve upon some of the other limitations of deep learning as well. So these neural networks don't work on everything, and we don't really quite understand when they work and when they fail. We don't understand what the problem is. And of course, another motivating thing for me is trying to understand how our brain works and going back and forth between deep learning and the brain, and there are actually much stronger analogies than you'd expect between the two. So in this vein, what we've done in my lab, and this is work that I did with while I was a postdoc in Rich B's lab, is we've built a theory that tries to derive convolutional networks in particular from first principles. And so we use what is known as a graphical model, which is a kind of probability representation for probability distributions. And what we've shown is that convolutional networks, which are shown all the way here at the right, are actually inference algorithms with respect to these kinds of graphical models. Now, I'm throwing some terminology at you, and there's a few steps in between, going from the left portion to the right portion of this image. And I refer you to our paper for the details. But the important thing is that this gets us one step closer to try and understand what convolutional nets actually are doing in their intermediate layers. And so some of the key properties of this model, which we call the deep rendering mixture model, is that it has, remember those nuisance variations I told you about in the first slide, the things that make perception hard? Well, this model has a bunch of latent variables to try and model those nuisance transformations explicitly. given those nuisance variables, the inference algorithm in this graphical model, so given some image here, how can I infer all the causes in the world that helped to create that image? The inference algorithm turns out to be exactly a convolutional neural network. And so what we're saying is that convolutional neural networks are not just black boxes, they're actually the right inference algorithm for this particular model, quantified by these equations here. So we can quantify everything and say that convolutional neural networks are actually a proper inference algorithm against this model, and every model has assumptions, and now we can sort of criticize those assumptions and think about those assumptions as opposed to wondering what's going on in the black box. In terms of learning, we can now use the so-called expectation maximization algorithm. The EM algorithm, of course, there are entire industries built on this. And so now we can use this EM algorithm to unify several kinds of learning, supervised, semi-supervised, and unsupervised learning, all in the same framework. And I will show a quick application of that near the end of my talk. So this is kind of the main theoretical result. It has a couple corollaries. One corollary is that every operation in a convolutional neural network has a probabilistic interpretation. And in particular, if you guys are familiar, some of these nonlinearities and max pooling inside convolutional neural networks, these have precise meanings relative to that model that I showed you before. Other kinds of questions we can answer that were previously unanswerable is we can when people used to probe these convolutional neural networks and generate all kinds of beautiful images to try and understand how they're actually storing their memories. Like, so what does the memory of a goose look like inside of a convolutional net? And you see here, we've kind of probed the convolutional net. We see mixture, we see kind of blending of all different kinds of geese with different poses. We can actually, and this is a pattern that qualitatively is reproduced no matter what category of object you try to probe for in the ComNet. So previously, this had no derivation, no proof. And we were the first to be able to actually prove, using our theoretical formalism, we were actually able to prove that it must be the case, that this kind of probing would always yield these sort of beautiful blending of different nuisance variables. So we're showing that the theory has some predictive power and explanatory power. Another thing we can do that previously was not able to be done is using a synthetically rendered data set called Blender Render, we can also probe the innards of a convolutional net and ask what kinds of other information does it have in there. So a convolutional net might be trained to classify objects, but we also know that it has to learn about all those nuisance variables in the world. If it didn't, it wouldn't be able to disentangle the nuisance from the target. And so the question is where is all that nuisance information stored and how is it formatted, right? It's not in JPEG, otherwise we would have discovered it. It's not in some human interpretable format, right? And so the beginnings of understanding how all that nuisance information is encoded in the black box is shown here, where we start probing the black box to ask each layer. We ask each layer in the convolutional net, how much information do you have about the rotation nuisance, about the translation nuisance, about the change in lighting nuisance, and so on, all the kinds of nuisances that occur naturally in images. So this is one step in our attempt to try and turn deep learning into more of a science and less of a reliance on black boxes. So the summary of this theory is that this theory tries to explain what convolutional nets are. One of the main implications of this theory is try to build a bridge between neuroscience, which I haven't had much time to talk to you guys about today. On the deep learning side, it hopefully will provide a principled way to alleviate a lot of the limitations of convolutional nets. And one intriguing insight is that as we try to fix some of these, alleviate some of these limitations, we're finding that we're basically starting to reproduce more and more features of brains, of actual brains. So introducing feedback connections, doing synaptic pruning, these kinds of things that happen in our brains that we're not aware of, we're actually finding reasons why we would want to include them in order to alleviate convolutional nets. So that's exciting. So one application that I'll end with is so-called semi-supervised learning. So what does this term mean? Well, when you look out into the world, you don't need all these labels. You don't need somebody to tell you what everything is, When you were 1 year old, you couldn't even understand what your parents were saying, but you did not need a bunch of labels for the world in order to be able to parse the world, right? And so you were learning in an unsupervised manner. You might get a few labels from your parents. Your mom might tell you this is a cat or this is a dog and so on. But the rest of the world, all the dozens and dozens of nuisances in the world, nobody ever told you, and yet you were able to parse them anyway, right? So you learned them unsupervised, we would say. So semi-supervised learning is about combining unsupervised learning, which doesn't require a teacher, with a little bit of supervision, where a teacher like your parent or an actual teacher might teach you something. So it's really trying to take one big step in the direction of how humans actually learn. So, and of course, there's an enormous amount of industry demand for semi-supervised learning because it is very costly to curate and label a bunch of data. You have to pay a lot of people and you have to worry a lot about the quality of the labels. It would be great for industry if we could learn in a semi-supervised manner, have a little bit of labeled data, which we've spent a good amount of money on, but for the rest of the data, if it was unlabeled and we could still learn from it, that would be amazing. So one application of this, which has been pioneered by one of the grad students here at Rice, Tan Nguyen, this is joint work with Rich Berenick's group as well, is to try and do semi-supervised learning in a principled way using that model, that deep rendering mixture model, which is shown here on the right. And so what we do is via these equations and via all these kinds of penalties, we create what's known as a loss function. And a loss function allows you to optimize for a particular task or a set of tasks, right? So it's like trying to teach this neural network how to learn, but only giving it a little bit of labeled data. So this neural network is allowed to see lots and lots of images, but I only give it a few labels about this is a cat, this is a dog, right? So trying to mimic more of the way children learn. And so if you're interested in the details of this, they're of course available in our most recent paper. And you can also talk to Tan offline. But we experimented, we used this theory to experiment on several benchmarks. And these are sort of classic benchmarks in deep learning. This is the MNIST benchmark of handwritten digits. This is SVHN, this is Google's Street View House Numbers benchmark. And this is SciFAR10 and our own synthetically rendered dataset, Blender Render. So the upshot is that using our theory and using some neat tricks, Tan was able to achieve state-of-the-art on this benchmark, beating out many other competitors, both from industry, so folks from Google and OpenAI, that's Elon Musk's startup. So we were able on several benchmarks to beat state-of-the-art, also on SVHN. And a couple benchmarks, we're near state-of-the-art, but we're still working on it. So this is exciting for us because it shows us that the theory can actually do real work. And the important thing, again, is that these experiments show that even though we have an enormous amount of data, the neural network only needs very, very few labels. Less than 0.1% of the data need be labeled. So this is, again, a very, very important application in industry. So that's just one example of the kind of projects we do in my lab. We really enjoy taking theory and neural inspiration and combining it to do real work in the real world. And so there are a variety of different kinds of projects which I'd be happy to talk to you guys about. They span everything from deep learning for particle physics and medical imaging, all the way down to more fundamental theoretical projects trying to understand deep learning in the brain. And so we like to have fun, and with that, I will end it and take any questions.
So Ankit is actually in the running for the award for the speaker to finish before the timer ran out.
Yes.
So, congratulations. So we have time for questions.
So when you described the Lexus accident, you said the problem was it saw this truck and thought it was a billboard. Mm-hmm. But it didn't seem to me, if I was driving the Lexus and there was a billboard right there, I would want the car to stop. So was it a visual recognition problem, or was it a what to do once you recognize problem?
And please repeat the question.
Yeah, so the question is, was it a visual recognition problem in the Tesla autopilot issue? Was it visual recognition to blame, or was it something else? And actually, it was a complicated interaction between the radar system and the visual recognition system. So the visual recognition system did misclassify the object as a billboard. But the radar system, which is usually used to confirm or reject the classification of the recognition system, has a special case in it for billboards. Because of the ambiguity of billboards, it's very difficult for the radar to tell whether the billboard is just a really big object far away or a small object up close. And due to that depth ambiguity, the radar system would have way too many false positives. And so they basically, if something is classified a billboard, the radar chooses to ignore, and that's why the brakes didn't go off. Yes?
How much complexity is? Because you have EM algorithm in it, so the complexity can be high or not?
So the complexity of the EM algorithm is actually not too bad, because due to the efficient inference of the DRMM model, which leads to convnets in the bottom-up inference and leads to very fast matrix operations in the top-down inference, it's actually not much, it's about the same cost as a convolutional net. But really what we're aiming at is a different use case where you have very, very little data available. And so it really changes the game in terms of you're not playing this game where you have to collect enormous amounts of data. You're kind of changing the game and saying, I need a little bit of data, but I can still learn from it. Yes?
You talked about semi-supervised for like images and even text, which are rather simple human tasks. What about if do you foresee semi-supervised being applied to something like thermodynamics or fluid mechanics or things that are kind of a little bit more complex? Do you see those needing more kind of a lot of training data, or semi-supervised is also possible?
So that's a great question. So in processes where there's a very fundamental equation that governs the dynamics, such as in anything based on laws of physics, the question is, shouldn't we just use the laws of physics? Aren't they the best model? And the answer to that is it depends. So for example, some of the work we're pursuing with Paul Padley's lab in the physics department here, in particle physics, you really have the true sort of ultimate generative model of the world, right? You actually, you literally know all the particles and how they interact. And so they have all the equations, and they can simulate from them using good software. The problem is that even though you have those equations, you can't invert them. Inverting them is a nightmare. And so so we see in particle physics, people using deep learning a lot, deep neural networks, random forests. So it depends. I would say that if your physical equations were very complex and hard to invert, then you'd still might want to use deep learning to invert them. Yes?
Just to clarify, I agree that deep learning is a good method. I was asking whether it's semi-supervised or fully supervised, which one of those would you use?
So if you have the labeled data, you should use it. All else equal, more labels is better. However, it's just the cost of acquiring labeled data is usually very high due to the high dimension of nuisances in the world. So if you have a very high dimensional nuisance, then I would probably suggest you try semi-supervised learning first before collecting all that data.
Oh, one more question. You can
select. As an optimizer, I wonder how hard it is to train these networks. Do you have problems like in the recurrent neural networks where you have the vanishing problem, vanishing gradient problem?
Yeah.
How hard is the training and the learning of the network?
So it's definitely a non-trivial problem. And one of the areas which I think is ripe for some sort of disruption is moving beyond gradient descent in these algorithms. People have come up with all kinds of fancier versions of gradient descent, but it's still gradient descent. And so that said, gradient descent still works reasonably well. And so people have not found, like in industry, for example, they haven't like moved away from gradient descent. It hasn't been an obstruction, but it would be really good if we could do something better.
We have nonlinear components, so there'll be room for second order derivatives and second order methods, right?
So second order methods are relatively costly on these networks, but mimicking second order methods with first order methods has been very valuable.
Do you have, instead of the Hessian, can you have access to, say, Hessian times vector?
So people have explored second-order methods, and the extra cost of evaluating the Hessian has been prohibitive.
Okay.
so far. So it hasn't been worth it yet, because the first order methods that are used to predict the Hessian instead have been good enough in practice. But that's not to say that there's not something better out there. It's still, I think it's a very open space. It would be very, very interesting to go beyond first order methods there.
Well, just before we thank Ankit, I'd just like to point out that he trained a deep neural network to cause this sign to crash down. Unbelievable.